Change into a piece of paper and it's drawn live on the screen. Now they're American, actually led by this Japanese lady who helped me. She was at the Tezuka Museum in Takarazuka, where Tezuka grew up, on the anniversary of Astro Boy, Principal Atom's birthday, which was April 7th, 2004. Is that right? 2003. And she sent me emails and photographs from her phone and things as she was there. When she was first there, she said, "It's really strange. I thought there'd be lots of people here this special day. There's hardly anybody here at all." She was there very early in the day. And then, like about half an hour later, I got an email from her saying, "The whole of Japan is here." She was, there were thousands of people had converged on this museum. And the reason they were there for that day was not just to see the museum, but was because there was a new exhibit. This was an exhibit of a life-size, or robot life-size, Astro Boy. And he was in a dark cabinet, and you couldn't see him, until you filed in, like in a museum, and the lights would come up, and Astro Boy would sit up and open his eyes and speak for the first time, as he did in the manga, speak to the public there. And of course, lots of people took photographs. He said, "Yes, if you take a photograph, I've just woken up for the first time." And then the lights went down, and of course, Astro Boy in the dark went back to sleep again. And then another huge crowd of people came in, and they did that all day. There were just lines and lines of people to come and see this moment when Astro Boy woke up. And in a way, I think that's a great symbol of what manga is really about. It is a kind of waking up, a kind of enlightenment to a new kind of life, not necessarily, not just a robot life, but a new way of seeing our everyday life. That moment of discovery of manga comes to you in many different ways. Maybe you discover it because you've seen Naruto on television or on DVD, and you buy the manga and say, "Hey, this is actually quite good." Or maybe you discovered it in the library, you discovered it through a friend on the internet, but there's always that moment where you find for the first time your fascination for manga and anime beginning. That's a very important point. And this is why, when I talk about or write about manga, I realize that for everybody in this room, it's probably something different. It's a different way into this subject. You might have tastes in common, but there are so many ways into this subject, whatever your interest might be, whether it comes from gaming, whether it comes maybe from Japanese horror movies, perhaps you can't from that. There are many ways to get you excited about this subject. What also excites me about manga is it actually is something that I am convinced is going to be something you'll enjoy in your whole life. It's not, I mean, you may have, probably you've got maybe parents perhaps or friends saying, "Oh, well, why are you into this stuff? I mean, also, it's just a phase. It's a phase you're going through. You know, you'll grow out of it. You'll become a proper adult." Well, as you know, if you're into science fiction for a start, it's something you can be enthusiastic and interested about for your whole life. And the reason why manga has been such a success is precisely because in Japan, they are addressing every kind of person and every kind of moment in your life. Whether you are 10 or 15, whether you're a boy or a girl, whatever your interest might be, there is a manga for you. I'm going to show the next slide. This is Peter Stanbury, who together we produced our books. Peter is the graphic designer, and I think he did a fantastic job on the manga book. I think, if you want to give him a round of applause. The graphic design of the book is so important. I hope you agree. It really is beautiful. It's got great big pictures, with good scanning and image choice. Because the book has to look wonderful as well, as hopefully tell you. I'm showing you here an example of a slider, I'm reminding myself. But this is a few images to kind of get you into the background of how you may get into comics and into manga. Just talk about it. The connection, of course, between manga and anime is really close. And it goes right back to Tezuka, who, as you may know, was as much animation director as he was a comic artist. He said, I think, that manga was his wife. Manga was his wife, but animation was his mistress. And that's because, of course, the mistress is very expensive, and animation is expensive. And he didn't actually lose money. His dream really was small. And in many ways, the strength of his manga, of course, is they are almost like film on paper. They are very visual, very cinematically, incredibly powerfully from page to page. And he was, as a child, he grew up with his father, watching his father's animation movies, particularly the Disney and Max Fleischer films, and longed to make his own. And it's interesting to see how that connection has continued right through today. The connection is very close to the point where I think certainly something around maybe 70%, possibly more, of anime, whether it's made for cinema or especially for TV, comes from manga, as you probably realize. And I meet people almost every, well, quite regularly, who tell me, I didn't realize this anime came from a manga. And many people also say to me, well, I'm not very keen on this manga because it's black and white. I prefer anime because it's colorful. Of course, that's one thing that most manga don't have. This is an example that was behind me on an anime comic, which you may also be aware of, which I think are an interesting kind of hybrid of film and comic, where they take the cells from the animation and convert them into a comics page. It's an interesting technique, and maybe it's a way of introducing people to reading manga. But I don't want to come across perhaps as being totally devoted to manga, to the exclusion of anime. But I think once you start discovering manga, you realize that this is the real stuff. I mean, in a sense of great good, I think that the animation shows a fantastic way to discover characters. But many people I've spoken to have said to me, well, yeah, we kind of like the animation. But once we found the manga, we realized this was the author totally in control. This was the author with his or her storytelling, not limited by having to be animated, or having to be made into an acceptable TV program, or having to be told in just maybe 26 episodes or so many minutes. As you know, manga stories can run as long as they need to run. And in many ways, there's more freedom to create strange ideas in manga than there is in anime. The simple reason for this is it costs so much. As I said, Jessica saw anime as his mistress. It's an expensive thing to produce an animation. This is going to change. We're already seeing the software available for people to make anime themselves, as you may know. I forget the name of the director, but there was a recent. Does anyone remind me? There's a Japanese director recently who made his own film. What's his name?
Right.
Have you seen the film?
Yeah.
It's good, isn't it? I mean, very impressive for one person to do this. It has to be one slightly mad person, I think, to be doing this amount of work. But it clearly, as the technology advances, just as we have amateur manga, we will have so-called amateur anime as well. Anime that will be one person's complete project. But so often, of course, anime is often expensive. It can be compromised by having to have lots of people funding it, accepting it. We know the struggles that people like Katsuhiro Otomo have had to bring his vision, what he wants to make into a film, to the screen. We know that's a problem. Whereas in manga, there's all kinds of freedom, because in the end, it's black and white, it's lots of pages, there's lots of room for things to be tried on a weekly basis, and to find an audience. This is why so much of anime comes from manga. It's the source of so many brilliant and unusual story ideas. At the same time, of course, anime is very strong, because it has great directors who produce original stories for manga, for film. Obviously, Tezuka himself, to Satoshi Kon, and many others who've done wonderful work directly for animation. But I think the other problem with anime, perhaps, is that it has the expectation of movement. We don't expect manga to move. We supply that. But if you think about so much animation, not just Japanese animation, but animation in general, there's almost the requirement that if it can move, we must make it move. And that gets in the way of the story. The story doesn't have to have spectacular flights of movement and special extra scenes added of action, for example. A manga can actually take time doing a lot of very slow, sensitive conversation between people over many, many pages. And I think this is where manga has a different register, a different way of engaging you as a reader, viewer. Now we'll take the next picture. Thank you. One thing that we're enjoying here take away, because in Japan, they are coming out mostly in weekly or bi-weekly or monthly magazines. This is the way they're really selling vast numbers. I mean, at one point, Shonen Jump was selling over 6 million copies when it had Dragon Ball and Yu-Gi-Oh! And things like that. But what we get them over here in the West generally has been, of course, in this book format. And here are three examples, of course, of Tezuka books in this format. And this is, of course, a slightly different way. It means we don't get our fix every week or every month. We wait for, say, every 2 months or so when a new book comes out, and you get 8 episodes, so maybe 10 episodes, in one big slice. This is the way the Japanese, of course, can be too, but the real, to my mind, the real kind of addictive hook, you realize the power of manga, as you read these as well, of course, the cliffhanger. It's the weekly installment that gets you week by week in real time. And we haven't really experienced that in the West very much yet. There was one attempt to do a magazine in America on a weekly basis that serialized things like Slam Dunk, for example, Fist of the Blue Star. When I was reading that, you really got an understanding of why manga work, because in the same way you get hooked on Lost or 24 or a soap opera, maybe, you've got to make that next episode. It just becomes essentially a part of your weekly ritual. But this format, as you know, is called Tankobon. This is a start size that's now become a standard format across the West for receiving and reading manga. And that's a major change, because as you may not be aware, back in the 80s, when manga were first being translated, certainly in America, they had the slightly dumb idea of taking manga stories and putting them into American comics, which are usually only about 32 pages long. And that was like every month, maybe every 2 weeks, but it was actually a really impractical and expensive format. Fortunately now, this is a format that's caught on around the world. The other format that we haven't seen a lot of here in the United States, certainly not in the West yet, is the smaller bookabon format. That's the one just there on the left, the Buddha format. Now that is even better than you, because it gives you anything up to about 400 pages, and it's smaller in size, so you'll get more on your bookshelf. And the good thing about those is they're usually the classic bestsellers, the very popular ones, maybe they're the cult series, but many series now are appearing in this format. And in France, that is now becoming another new format that's catching on. Maybe we'll see that happening here in Finland too. That allows you to get a bigger watch, a bigger chunk of story on a regular basis. Okay. I'll switch to the next one. That's okay. His characters are fascinating because, as you may be aware, he had like a kind of cast of characters, almost a cast of actors, in fact. If you've read it, maybe you've seen it in my book, I mentioned briefly, but he had actually even made up careers and press clippings reviewing their performances in his manga. He even had a list of his actors, including, of course, Astro Boy. With their salaries, he pretended that he was a film studio with the stars. All his characters were stars. And so you may find, as you read more of Tezuka's stories, you'll find that characters will pop up in sort of cameos or maybe in supporting roles. And this is a very unusual approach to the idea of having a troupe of actors that can perform your comics. And it's an example, I think, because of this enthusiasm for the film format, even treating these comics as a kind of film performance. What I'm showing you here is actually a page from Princess Knight, which was, in many ways, seen as the beginning of shoujo manga, girls' comics. And this character began in the 50s. And although it was written by Tezuka, it was formed in a girls' comic, and it established a lot of the interesting themes of been true to shoujo manga ever since. Princess Knight, as you may be aware, is actually a girl, she's a princess, but she is not able to rule in her land because the throne, the crown, can only go to a man, to a son. So she has to spend her life in disguise as a man. But here, she is actually had a bit of an escapade, dressed up as a usual, regular girl's outfit, gets caught and has to make a daring escape and return back to her disguise. This whole interesting gender identity question is something that Tessica, in particular, identified very strongly with. The reason this theme is so strong in Tessica's work is partly, I think, because he grew up in Takahashi's work, where there's a very famous troupe of actors and music of women who perform the most amazing revues, where women play both the female and the male roles. His mother was a friend of one of the main actresses in this Takahashi review, which is still going now in Japan. And as a young boy, Tessica would sit in the front row and stare up at these heavily made-up women, often with quite exaggerated makeup, and at the same time also with the spotlights shining on their faces. And their eyes, of course, would sparkle and reflect the spotlights. And all of that is where these huge, sparkling eyes that we associate with shoujo manga came from. It comes partly, at least, from that theatrical background that Tessica grew up with, seeing the big emotions portrayed on the stage. This is actually a bilingual comic. One way to read, and maybe to learn Japanese too, is to pick up these bilingual manga. They're published by Kodansha. And they often have stories that you can't find in English. There's a Greek series that are not available in English, but you can buy them in Japanese and English bilingual editions. And this is one of them where you can read it together and learn, maybe learn your Japanese from that. Okay, next one. Thank you. Right, this actually was the very first magazine that I bought in 1980. People ask me when I discovered Manga. Well, I mean, I discovered the Japanese bookshops in London, and one of the first ones I bought was this. Just because I was amazed, if you've seen Japanese manga magazines, they are sort of maybe 500-600 pages long. And if you're used to ordinary comics, whether here or in Britain, they're usually maybe 32 pages if you're lucky. To have that much material coming out every week was just mind-blowing. It was like getting all of your weekly comics, or all of your, in one go, all inside one package. And I realized it's also a bit like having a whole week's television, in a way, in one magazine, because you could switch from a humorous, a mad, crazy story, you'll go to a sports story, or a historical one, or a science fiction one, and there would be a whole selection box of different material in there, and at an amazingly affordable price, too. Now, this is Shonen Magazine, one of the three biggest weekly still going now, Shonen Jump, Shonen Sunday, Shonen Magazine, are the big three, still selling enormous numbers. Boys comics, of course, Shonen is the term for boys. And the comic that I particularly liked in this, the first one, I don't know why I liked it really, because I was quite young at the time, but it was called Fishing Crazy Sanpei. Again, it's going to be put into English. And it's all about a kid who is really good at fishing and catches the most amazingly rare species, has all the techniques, and the perfect way to catch them. And it's a very informative fact, but it has lots of information about the fish themselves. And the comic was printed in a kind of blue ink, as you may be aware if you've seen manga magazines, like a weeklies like this. They don't have colour, they have a bit of colour. They have maybe colour at the front, occasional title page. Basically, it's cheap newsprint, it's black and white, but sometimes it's on coloured paper, and sometimes it's in a coloured ink. And the combination of that and this beautiful artwork, which often looked like a print, like a print from the 19th or 18th centuries, a ukiyo-e floating world print of this boy with fishing, and these fish leaping out of the water very dramatically. There's actually an image of it in the book. Just amazing, because it was actually exciting and riveting, even though, I mean, to me, fishing is not really the most exciting subject in the world. In fact, far from it, I was much more into science fiction and fantasy. And that's what manga can often do. They'll take a subject which seems quite banal, really, and make it engaging and exciting. I know there's a series on around now which I haven't got around to reading yet. It's a new series that's been a big hit, I think, in Shonen Jump, all about bakery, baking goods. Have you heard about this one? I think somebody knows it, you may know about it. But it's the guy is learning how to make a new bread product for Japan, because Japanese don't eat traditionally, they don't eat a lot of bread. kind of subject matter you would never dream of reading about, maybe, is a one called Iron Wok Jam, which is all about wok cookery. And this is not a sort of sedate wok cookery. This is pyrotechnic, spectacular wok cookery, to the point where when the guy makes a particularly successful recipe and stuff will have got into the air, and there'll be a huge firework display of flames and things, and it's very, very exciting. It's also competitive. It's a competition. He has to win. But it's a subject that's, why not? I'm wok cookery manga. The whole point is that the Japanese seem to have no problem about any subject matter. Anything can be made an exciting story, can be made interesting in manga form. One of the recent new series that just came out in English is a whole series of histories of famous companies and products. It's not necessarily appealing to all of you in the audience right now, but one of them I was amazed to see is actually a serious documentary manga about the history of the pot noodle. Do you know what pot noodles? Well, why not? I mean, it's actually apparently a very exciting story, how they developed it, and the whole background is a whole business story, and that's become another example of the kind of manga that we produced. So maybe that's some of the selection. Let's look at the next one, right? Yeah. Explain alternative technology we're looking at here is a curious mixture of 20th century and 21st century. Because I have 20th century slides, which nobody uses anymore, of course, everyone uses PowerPoint and things, but combined with a wonderful bit of technology, it all becomes digitized. You can see that. This actually is an example of an article, Nagai Go. Nagai Go is a phenomenon in Japan, but I think we haven't seen enough of his work, certainly enough of his manga in the West yet. For some reason, I don't know why it hasn't been. His most famous series are probably Cutie Honey and Devil Man, and also, of course, the robot series he was famous for, too. But this is actually an example of his exuberant, wild, slightly dangerous comic artwork appearing again in that boys' comic I bought in 1980. And it's the kind of imagery which we're just not used to seeing in Western comics. Quite horrifying at times, quite violent, but thrilling, you know, beautifully executed. And that goes with actually something I think that we will hopefully get to see more of in English in the future in other languages. He's easily up there with someone like Masumoto and others of that sort. Okay, next one. Now the first manga that really crossed over internationally is Bear Again. Who's read Bear Again? It's not a great barrel of laughs. It's a bit grim, actually, as it has to be. But of course, the reason it was translated was not because it was a manga. I mean, part of it was in comics form. It was translated because of the message, of the anti-nuclear message that was such an important subject, at least clearly today. It was translated in the late 70s, and the origins of it being translated are very interesting. There was actually, in America in the mid-70s, there was a peace march, apparently, done every year, where peace activists meet and they walk literally from coast to coast across America. And there were quite a few Japanese activists amongst this group in around 1976 who had copies of Bear from Game with them, and they showed the book around to people on this peace march across America. And the Americans were saying, this is a fantastic book, why hasn't it been put into English? It wasn't simply anime, but simply this is a really important story about the horrors of the after effects of the bombing of Hiroshima. And out of that came a project, a whole bunch of volunteers, done literally for the love of the subject matter and for the importance of the message. And as a result, Bear Again became the first manga to be widely available in many languages, first in English and then, well, for example, in Finnish, as you can hear, it's also available around the world. Unfortunately, so far, there's only been about four of the, at least 10 volumes that we put into English. But I gather that the latest editions are going to be completing the whole 10 volume cycle of the story. And I think the power of the story is undeniable. I mean, you may not want to read it, it makes you very uncomfortable. It's just horrifying to see what Japanese endured, and what essentially the West, or America at least, did to the Japanese with these bombings. But the message is a very interesting manga because it doesn't come out as being very strongly anti-American. You might think it would actually be very, very much in that view. In fact, if anything becomes, the first book is actually quite critical of the war machine in Japan at the time. Certainly the whole hierarchy that was insisting that that the war was a good thing and that sacrifice was noble and we shouldn't in any way be a pacifist and object to it. And the power of the story will continue to make it one of the great masterpieces. Although in terms of the drawing, it actually is quite old-fashioned. I mean, some people will want to see this style of manga because it's very much the 50s and 60s Tezuka classic style. Okay, next one.
The adult
comics coming in the late 60s. This character is still going strong now. It's amazing he's carried on. He's one of the few, actually, doing that, I think, one of the few characters who's lasted so long. And usually, manga stories have a certain life. They have a certain kind of story to tell. They may come back to them in the future, but usually they have an end. And that's actually one of the things that I think makes manga so fresh and exciting, is that there are new stories. There's room made for new stories to come in. Part of the problem with comics in the West, and the reason why manga has actually caught on now, is because Western publishers didn't change. They stayed with the same kinds of stories, the same characters. They didn't address you. Clearly, you didn't find what you wanted in the comics that were being published maybe in Finland or in England or in America. And it was manga that filled that gap. This is always a mistake, I think. The publishers settle on a formula and stay in the same character. Not to be rude, but for example, the film this summer that America wants you to enjoy, of course, is Superman Returns. And for many people, of course, who are younger, they have never seen the Superman movies in the 70s and early 80s. The character is kind of made new again, it's a new character. But it's a character that's been around for nearly 70 years. In 2008 would be Superman's 70th anniversary. And there are not many characters that have got that much. Well, maybe they're going wrong. Maybe they do have a certain mythic appeal. But of course, these are properties. These are owned not by the creators, they're owned by the publishers, DC Comics, which is part of Time Warner AOL. And for them, it's a franchise, it's a product that they keep on licensing and need to keep renewing every 5, 10 years or so, bring it out again. Whereas in manga and anime, there's room for new characters all the time. There's room for new ideas to come through. And by and large, they may last a long time. I mean, they may run for maybe a decade or maybe longer, but there are very few that have been kept going in continuous publication for 70 years. I don't think any of us have been going that long. And certainly not being given to many different artists to say, hey, you know, just do what you can. Please rescue our character. We can't do more with it. What could you do to keep it going? Okay, the other thing I meant to be talking, I think, about the effect of manga on comics in the world, and not just in terms of their export, but how they're changing the way comics are produced. I may not have much chance to talk about that. I want to get through these slides fairly quickly now. This is actually a sequel to Fist of the North Star or Fist of the Blue Star. As you may be aware of the anime series, of course, with Ken, the super-powered, tough guy character. It was very interesting speaking to some Japanese people about their love of this character. For them, when they were sort of maybe 8 or 10, the program was on television. For them, it was so violent and terrifying. But they loved it at the same time, of course, because it did upset their parents, and it was on primetime television, and it wasn't really quite acceptable. And for them, this was an iconic character that has definitely grown up with. And in fact, doing this manga book, I did a lot of conversation with readers of manga. That was almost as important as trying to contact the artists themselves to find out the effect that manga had on you. And I really realized that these are stories, as in fact Jeff Vandermeer's film was saying, I think, when you saw the film, about the importance of telling stories. We tell ourselves stories, we read other people's stories, try and make some sense, or to try and see the world, try and understand the world. And manga have an amazing impact on their readers. They can often really shape values, they can actually even change their lives. One woman I spoke to had read a lot of shoujo manga, especially characters like Rose of Versailles by Yuki Ikeda, which is a very empowering story for women. And a great many shoujo manga have that example of women making their own way. And this is Michiko Chiba, was living in London. And she had really still remembered those comics so well, because for her they were like an example to say, you don't have to be a kind of quiet housewife, mother, you could actually have a different life as a woman, you could actually make your own path through life. And in many ways, these manga stories are giving people other ways of living, giving you ways of imagining your life differently. course, the other kind of way that manga is inspired in a very strong way are the stories of people overcoming obstacles. So many successful characters are so popular, like Naruto, for example, characters who are like underdogs, characters who don't, who maybe are kind of put down, some of the misfits, outcasts, who kind of find their way, don't have a super skill, and they make their way through adversity to achievement, to actually becoming accepted. And that's a very important role that manga plays. It can actually allow people to explore those issues in their lives. We all have issues of figuring out why we're here, what we're doing, what's important to us to try and achieve. Okay, next one. Oh yeah. This is just to show you two more examples of bilingual comics I was mentioning to you. GTO, of course, is actually available now in English, but it was the first time I could read it, was in the Kodansha bilingual editions. The other one that hasn't been put into English yet, the back of one, is actually completely mad, wonderfully lunatic stuff. You may have seen the anime. This is a whole area where I think we're still at this time to see the humour of Japan, Japanese anime and manga coming into the West. It's quite easy to get this, some of the genres we are getting, the science fiction ones and the martial arts, the fantasy ones, of course, but the humour. There's a kind of idea that maybe humour in manga and anime is difficult to translate, but actually some of the successful ones recently have been humour ones. One big hit recently, currently, certainly in America and in Britain, is Cromarty High School. Have you heard of Cromarty High School? Anyone know Cromarty High School? You do? So you have a future, yes. It's mad, completely mad. And wonderful for it. It's kind of like Monty Python, if you know Monty Python, where you have a high school where amongst the pupils you have Freddie Mercury from Queen, and you have a giant, you have a gorilla, and you have a tin can robot who nobody quite gets around to saying that he's a robot, and they have nervous of saying, but you're a robot, what are you doing? And there's been an anime version of it, and then just recently, a very, very funny live action movie version of Comedy Lesson 2, which is complete lunatic stuff. And I think hopefully we will get to see more of the humor material in manga translated, because it's very funny. And while it has obviously cultural references that we will be explaining, there's also a lot of humor to be drawn from the manga material. Okay, next up. Well, I was just to show you the way that manga were first translated into American comics by being colorized. And that whole issue of color, of course, does come up, and manga, of course, have actually established a black and white comic as being a standard format now. Whereas for a longest time, you think about it, American comics had to be full color, and European comics, like Tintin or Asterix, had to be in full color on our backs. The fact is that manga had a big effect internationally by establishing that comics can be black and white, and I see them on television. It is actually an innovation. And of course, since black and white is cheaper, you can get a lot more pages. That is another crucial thing, I'll talk more about that tomorrow, that the number of pages to tell a story really changes how you can enjoy a comic and the kind of things that you can tell in a comic. This was the example I was mentioning to you about not being able to experience manga in the way the Japanese do. It's just one exception in terms of experiencing on a weekly basis. This was a very great attempt in America a few years back to bring out a weekly comic called Raijin, which gave you about 300 pages of serials, very good stuff, from Slam Dunk to this is called Baki the Crackler, which is some of the most frightening and violent wrestling I've ever seen. Some very nasty stuff going on in it, very exciting. And that was coming out every week for over a year. It was actually financed by a Japanese company who did this because the authors that they were publishing felt that they weren't getting a proper deal by getting published in the West. There's a whole backstory which we don't go into in this book about the problems that the Japanese authors have with how their work is translated. And some of them weren't happy about the flipping or flopping of their artwork. They weren't happy with the changes that are made. They also weren't even being paid properly in some cases. This is a controversial subject. But what happened, a whole group of artists, including Inoue, of course, who did Slam Dunk, took their material from the publishers in Japan and said, well, let's have our own group, it's called Gatsu, and they put together this magazine which put their titles out, and then improving what was done to the artwork. And for, as I say, about a year or so, it was a great way to get to experience Manga on a weekly basis. And my dream is still that maybe eventually here in the West, that there will be some publishers who will try putting Manga onto the newsstands in this way. Obviously in America you've got Shonen Jump and Shoujo Beat, which come out monthly, and that at least gives you a taste of what the Manga experience is really like when you read it this way.
Interesting things for the near future to come in Manga may not come from Japan at all,
he thinks they may come from Europe, from the West, from America as well, because we can mix together all our, all we learn from Manga with our own culture and our own comics and create an amazing culture of our own in Manga that are uniquely special to ourselves. Good, I'll wrap it up there. Have you got, do you have time for questions, or are we going to wrap up? No time for questions. I talk too much. I'm sorry. But you can talk to me anytime I'm around to this weekend. And about 3 o'clock or so, in a few minutes, I'll be at the Midway stand if you want to get your copies on the website. And I'll also just briefly wrap up. One last thing to mention is that a new book we've got coming out, just a new book, which is out already in English. It'll come out in September next year from Ottawa. And it's a beautiful book about graphic novels and includes Manga as well. Includes Manga as well. And that'll be coming out next year, but that's the latest book that came out last year. And tomorrow I'll be talking about a talk which is called Page to Page, Panel to Panel. And this is going to be looking at more closely at how the language of comics, the language of Manga works. And you know how they work because you read them, but you may not perhaps realize just how sophisticated they are and what they, how they're changing comics, how they've made them even a richer language than before. Thank you very much for coming. Enjoy the rest of the convention. See you later.